Good evening, everyone. Welcome you all to another exciting session of Oncology Classroom. Today evening, we are going to discuss on radiation planning in carcinoma anal canal. And to take this session, today we have Dr. Tanvi Shahid with us. Dr. Tanvi Shahid is a senior consultant radiation oncologist at Apollo Gleneagles Hospital, Kolkata, and one of the most prominent faces in radiation oncology fraternity of the country. I must say that his classes are one of the most wonderful classes we had so far. Thank you so much, sir, for being with us. And may I now request you to take over the session and start your class. Thank you once again.
Okay. Hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, good evening, everyone. At the onset, I'd like to thank Dr. Dodul for arranging these classes. And time and again, I feel that arranging these classes is of utmost. It's a very, very challenging things to do. It's not at all easy. And it's a daunting task to arrange this kind of classes. So we all must be thankful to Dodul that he keeps on educating us, and he spoke a lot of kind words for me, which I certainly believe he, so to begin with, we'll start today with radiotherapy planning in carcinoma anal canal. When I got this topic, I was really very excited, and even I thought that though the things are not very clear in anal canal, though it sounds to be that this particular organ, it is easy to treat, but it's really not, because we all have treated this anal canal cancers, and we have felt that the toxicity is the most limiting factors what hampers in the continuation of this treatment. So right from the treatment starting till execution till completion, it's not easy, and specifically it is when it is combined with chemotherapy, which is the standard treatment as far as anal canal carcinoma is concerned. So treatment of anal canal is basically, it's a journey which has evolved in the due course of time. And anal canal cancers, we all know it's not that common. It is relatively rare, I mean. And in 1 year maximum, what we see at an average in our hospital is around 12 to 15 patients that we see. That's the maximum. And particularly, I have written this word from Negro to Plateau. Negro, we everybody know. And Plateau, I'm sure that many of you all know.
Sir?
Hello?
So you need to share your screen.
Is my screen not shared?
No, sir, it's not visible. We can see you, but not the presentation.
Okay, just a can you see now?
Yes, sir.
Can we see?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. So, hope my screen is being seen, and I'm audible also, both the ways, okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, everything is correct.
Okay, fine. Thank you so much. So, treatment of canal cancer, it is a rare disease, the treatment has evolved as a journey, and I call it as a Negro to Plateau. Negro, we all know, and the Plateau, in my due course of presentation, I'll explain that Most of you all might be knowing that about plateau, but yet I'll discuss this topic. Okay. So to begin with, I mean anatomy in a very brief. We all know that anal canal measures around 4 centimeters in length, and it is basically it can be divided into two parts by a dentate line. Above the dentate line, the epithelium is different, which is columnar, and below the dentate line, it is basically squamous epithelium. There is anal verge, and beyond the anal verge is the perianal skin. And why this is important? Because even anatomically, and along with that, the lymphatic drainage above the pectinate line can be different. Below it is different, and even the tumors which are in the perianal skin is managed differently. Inguinal lymph node drainage is of a paramount importance because that itself decides that what should be your treatment volume and the portals. You know, so in anal canal, this is particularly it is very very important. I'll just briefly touch upon the AGCC 8th edition, which is basically the T staging is based on the size of the tumor. The T1 is basically it is 2 centimeters or less. 2 to 5 is T2. T3 is more than 5 centimeters, and T4 if it invades into the adjacent structures, it is T4. The nodal volume is again it is much simplified in the 8th edition. N1 there is no N2 and N3. It is basically N1 A, B, and C. The N1 A. It is basically it either it involves the mesorectal or the perirectal group of lymph nodes or the internal iliac or the inguinal lymph node, then it is N1A. And its N1B is primarily the external iliac group of lymph nodes. And NC, basically you can say the combination of A and B, that is external iliac, that is N1B, and any of the N1A is combined, it will be called as N1C. So again, it's much simplified. If you look at the in a snapshot, what is the management of anal canal? We all know that if it is adenocarcinomas, whether it is in a distal rectum or in the anal canal itself, it will be managed like a CA rectum. But if it is a squamous cell carcinoma, then the treatment is primarily it is always it is standard of treatment is concurrent chemo radiation, no doubt about that. And but if the tumor is in the perianal skin, and what do you mean by perianal skin? It is if from the margin around the 5 centimeters around the anal the diameter or around the anal verge is basically the anal margin, and if anal margin has a tumor, and primarily if there is no involvement of the anal sphincters, it is basically it will be regarded as a skin tumor. Which is arising in the perianal skin area, and the treatment will be surgery, that is wide local excision. This slide is prepared by Ashish. I mean, it's a very fascinating slide. I liked it a lot, where the treatment has been described in a nutshell, where the started with the Negro, and this is where we are at the present, that is plateau, and in between we have all those evolvement, the way that the treatment has progressed, which I'll again deal in my subsequent slides. Now, we start the presentation from here. This gentleman, that is Norman Negro, I mean, from in 1974, just with three cases, which he, in fact, he had presented in a gastro meeting in USA, where he and his two colleagues, that is Vetkefisius and Considine, and Norman Negro, in fact, he was working in the Department of Surgery, and the radiation oncologist was basically Considine. And in just three patients, where they gave 30 gray of radiation in 3 weeks, along with 5-FU and mitomycin C, and they got a complete response. And that they presented it as a report, in fact, a case report in a meeting. And from 1974 and beyond, he went on to publish in 1981 with 19 patients, and in 1983 with 28 patients. You can say in these two decades, concurrent chemo radiation became the standard of care. And we all will be very surprised that till date, we don't have any kind of randomized controlled trial which has compared surgery with the concurrent chemo radiation. Though before 1970s, I mean, the surgery was the standard of care. But till date, we don't have any randomized controlled trial, and we should not have, because the standard of care has already been proven beyond doubt to be concurrent chemo radiation. So this was a journey which started in 70s. Continued for the next two decades, where it was established that concurrent chemo radiation is the standard of care. Now, what I was mentioning about plateau, plateau is something which is a trial, ongoing trial, which is a personalized anal cancer radiotherapy doses. So that's called as plateau. And it's basically based on these three trials, that is Act 3, Act 4, and Act 5. Simple, very simple to remember. Act 5, 5 is the highest dose, we can highest number among this 3, 4, and 5. So 5 deals with the dose escalation. So 5, the numerical 5 is the maximum among 3, 4, and 5. So it's easier to remember. It deals with the dose escalation in anal cancer. And then what is 4? Just reverse of 5, that it deals with the dose de-escalation. Now, when we talk about escalation and de-escalation, what is the benchmark where we are thinking that is the escalation or a de-escalation? It is basically the Act 2 trial, which where the dose of concurrent chemo radiation doses of 50.4 gray. So from that 50.4 gray benchmark, escalation is 5 and de-escalation is 4. And Act 3 is basically those specific small subgroup of patients where who undergo surgery, early T1, and where the margins are positive, I mean less than 1 mm, and where you could give low dose radiation to find out that how is the outcome. So that deals with Act 3. Still an ongoing. So this is more of a personalized radiotherapy doses. So going on to the from Negro to Plateau, but in between that, in 1970s, when Negro presented his paper and till the next two decades when concurrent chemo radiation became a standard of care. And concurrent chemo radiation, when we say the radiation along with chemotherapy, and chemotherapy is 5-FU and mitomycin C. So by 90s, we were sure that the treatment is radiotherapy with chemotherapy, and chemotherapy happens to be 5-FU and mitomycin C. Human mind is always, it keeps on pondering that what new we can do. So similarly, in this also, it was seen that can we avoid chemotherapy and just go with radiation? Because by this time, radiation with chemotherapy was established. So for that, UKCCR, that is United Kingdom Coordination Committee for Cancer Research, which is also called as Act 1 trial, in 1996, they published a trial where radiation was compared with concurrently with radiation and 5-FU and mitomycin C. And what they found out that concurrent chemo radiation is superior in the terms of local failure and the colostomy-free survival. That's one thing. After Act 1, I'll deal with the EORTC 1997. Again, the same question was asked whether radiation can be compared with radiation with chemotherapy. So can chemotherapy be taken out? And again, it was found that no, the concurrent chemo radiation is the standard of care. So chemotherapy cannot be taken out. So then they found out, okay, fine, the concurrent chemotherapy cannot be taken out. That's fine. We do accept, and 5-FU does work in the GIT. Again, we do accept, but why the mitomycin C was used? Mitomycin C was basically, it was used as an empirical by Negro and his colleagues, and it went on to continue, and they thought that can the mitomycin C be removed? Okay, chemotherapy is definitely essential, but why the mitomycin C? So that comparison was seen in the RTOG 8704, where radiation with 5-FU was compared with radiation, 5-FU and mitomycin C. And again, it was found that mitomycin C does has a better disease-free survival and a colostomy-free survival. So here again, 5-FU and mitomycin C along with radiation was the standard of care. And this was proven in the late 90s. So it's a journey which I told in my first slide from 1970s till 1990, where we came. And then the era came where in this millennium we came. And here, Jafar Ajani from MD Anderson Cancer Center, he is basically a GI man, a big name in GI, Jafar Ajani. So Jafar Ajani thought that in RTOG 9811, he thought that, okay, 5-FU plus mitomycin C, we do accept. But if it's a squamous cell carcinoma, and squamous carcinoma in head and neck, it does respond with cisplatin plus 5-FU. So can it happen that 5-FU plus mitomycin C vis-a-vis, can it be compared with cisplatin and 5-FU? And again, we all might think that why the people, they wanted to take off this MMC, or why again they wanted to experiment it, because somewhere down the line, it was been thought that mitomycin C definitely adds the toxicity. So can it be substituted by a more simpler drug, that is cisplatin and 5-FU? And here the cisplatin and 5-FU, it was given in the Jafar Ajani's, that is RTOG 9811. It was given as an induction chemo two cycles, and then radiation with cisplatin and 5-FU. So cisplatin and 5-FU, two cycles of induction followed by RT with cisplatin and 5-FU. Vis-a-vis the comparison was RT plus 5-FU MMC. And again, it was found that MMC, it did, the MMC arm did better. And cisplatin failed to improve the disease-free survival. And the worst part was the colostomy rate was much higher in the cisplatin arm. RTOG 9811, again, 4 years later, it did come with an update where, again, these things were again reiterated that 5-FU plus mitomycin C is definitely superior as compared to 5-FU and cisplatin with combined with RT. In the meantime, 13 years later, Act 1, that is UKCCR, which was initially it was published in 1996 and now it's published in 2010, the update again said that concurrent chemo radiation is definitely superior to radiation alone. The last two trials which I'll be discussing is that ACCORD trial and the Act 2. I'll start with the Act 2 first, though it was published later in 2013. But why Act 2 was very important after Act 1? Because Act 2 till date, it has the highest number of patients ever approved in the CNL canal cancers. 900 odd patients divided into four arms. It was a 2x2 factorial design. And what was very important in this, in the four arm, standard arm was radiation with 5-FU MMC, which we all accept. But the other arm did have a radiation plus 5-FU plus cisplatin. And it went on to continue with the maintenance chemotherapy. That was a difference in this in 2x2 factorial design, that both the arms, after completion, the treatment, they went on to complete the to take maintenance chemo. And again, it was found that 5-FU plus mitomycin C in a concurrent setting, it remains the standard, and there is no role of maintenance therapy with cisplatin and 5-FU. Though it's a negative trial, but it did come out with an answer that maintenance chemotherapy doesn't have a role, and why it is another important that it's the highest number of patients accrued till date in any anal canal cancer. So that's the beauty of this trial. ACCORD 3 published 1 year earlier in JCO, and again, here is easier to remember. Act 2 dealt with the maintenance chemotherapy, but ACCORD 3 dealt with the induction chemotherapy. Again, 2x2 factorial design, induction chemotherapy. And it was again found that there is no benefit of adding induction chemotherapy. So whether you take induction chemotherapy or a maintenance chemotherapy, you don't have an added advantage. So till 2013, we can say that from 74 till 2013, nearly more than three decades, one thing is clear, that concurrent chemo radiation happens to be the standard of care. This is the history, whatever, and I really get fascinated by saying this history because it is so interesting. So from the above discussed trials, we come to a conclusion that concurrent chemo radiation is the standard of care, no doubt about it. And radiation is an integral component, again, no doubt about it. So being a radiation oncologist, how do we proceed for radiation? That's the question. And that's basically the topic why we're dealing today. Now, what was important that we are planning for radiation and we need guidelines. And we certainly have guidelines. We have many guidelines to follow, RTOG Act and AITCG, that is Australasian guidelines. Now, all these guidelines, they have their own differences or own intricacies. But before going to the guidelines, let's see that what should be the volume, what we want to treat. And in simple, plain language, two things, that is primary tumor and the regional lymph nodes. So very simple. So before we dive into the guidelines, let us see that the regional lymph nodes and radiation field design. As I told in my second slide, that the lymph nodal lymphatic drainage in CNL canal is very, very important because it decides upon the not only about the elective volume what you are treating, but even the dose what you are giving. You are tailoring your dose according to the involvement of the lymph node. And it's very interesting that upfront itself, nearly one third of the patient they present with the inguinal lymphadenopathy. That is something very, very, I mean, important to note. And as I mentioned in my second slide itself, that anal canal, though it is 4 centimeters and divided into two parts, above and below. So if you look, the tumors which are really near the verge, that is anal margin, they have more likely to involve inguinal lymph nodes than the anal canal, that is, which can be said that which is above the pectinate line. So if it is towards the anal verge, you have more chances of having the inguinal lymph node involvement. And pelvic lymph node involvement is again, nearly 30% of the patients will have a pelvic lymph node involvement. And that too, if the and pelvic lymph node involvement will be much more if the tumor arises from the more from the anal canal, that is towards the rectum. We can say that's the important part. Now, prerequisite for radiation therapy, again, this holds true for, I think, any radiation therapy, not only per se the anal canal, but in relation to the anal canal, digital rectal examination is very important. And for that, not only the extent of the disease from the anal verge and what, whether it's a concentric, non-concentric, which clock position it is, whether it is bleeds on touch, doesn't bleeds on touch, and all those findings, examination findings, we say the very important point is what is the tone, anal sphincter tone. And though we describe the distribution of the growth in our own way, but sphincter tone is again very, very important. Palpation of inguinal lymph nodopathy, as I told, because one third of the patients will be presenting with the inguinal lymph node. And especially for the females, the vaginal examination is important because it will also decide upon your T staging and if there is an advanced disease, if there is any fistula. So that also has to be kept in mind. Radiological imaging, it plays a very, very important role because that will help you to stage your tumor. MRI is again, as I always say, MRI has an excellent soft tissue contrast, and because of the multiplanar imaging, it will give you a very detailed description about your extent of the disease. And for your metastatic work of CT scan, abdomen, pelvis, and thorax is again is important. PET scan, though I have written, is an optional, but I like to say that it's an excellent imaging modality because of the negative predictive value is very high. Negative predictive value, we all know that if the PET CT says no, it will be no. And if it says yes, then you start thinking that whether it is really yes. So negative predictive value is very high. To rule out distant mets, again, PET CT is an excellent modality, especially for my younger colleagues in examination, CT scan, abdomen, pelvis, if you say that's good enough, MRI, pelvis will definitely be, again, it's a mandatory examination, you can say. PET CT scan for an optional, for the examination purpose, we can say. Now, coming on to the simulation part. The positioning, we know it can be more both the ways. Either it can be supine or it can be prone. We also don't know that the supine is always a comfortable position. It can be easily reproducible. A bolus can be kept in the inguinal region. And even if you require an electron field, it can be easily given. Prone is, again, we know the advantage because you can see the tumor extent. You can even see the fields if you're doing a clinical planning. And you can add the perianal bolus. And the most important why we do is the sparing of the small bowel. But disadvantage is, again, the reproducibility. It's uncomfortable for the patient. And also the electron field becomes a limiting factor. Immobilization devices, again, very standard immobilization devices. If you're using the supine posture, it's commonly what we follow is a frog leg position, and it can be with an under knee rest, or you can even use a back lock. And of course, supine has an excellent reproducibility, that is no doubt about it. And frog leg position, it helps basically, it allows the separation of the upper half of the thigh. And it also prevents the bolus effect in that region. That is very important because that can reduce your skin toxicity. And it also, and in the anal region, once you make a frog leg position, the two buttocks, it opposes each other, and that can act as an auto bolus. That is another something very important. Belly board, we know the advantage because it can just spare your bowel. That's one thing. Bladder filling protocol is ideally, it's better because you can spare your bowels. But again, daily reproducibility becomes an issue. Radiopaque marker, we always put at an anal verge because that will decide upon your treatment field, and also it will aid in your contouring. Slices are usually your around 3 mm slices with IV contrast from diaphragm to mid thigh. That's a very basic which we all know, no doubt about it. And just to say that whether belly board versus full bladder or both. So if you have an option, definitely the belly board and full bladder, definitely both. If you can use both, is definitely the best because you can spare the bladder. But that is again, it's more of an institutional practice what we do. We are treating all our patients in supine position and full bladder. That's what we, but as per paper and guidelines, if you see, it definitely looks that the sparing is much better if you can use the full bladder and belly board. Again, if you're doing an IMRT, it is supine versus prone, belly worded versus no full bladder versus empty bladder. What? So if you're doing an IMRT, belly board becomes an optional and it's more of an individualized. Supine position is definitely superior to prone because the reproducibility and comfort for the patient. And the bladder volume, as I said, that the full bladder is no doubt it's very it is helpful because your doses to the small bowel will be decreased. But again, you have to remember that the day-to-day variation will be a limiting factor. So that you have to keep it in mind. Coming on to the radiation planning, for any radiation planning, again, we as a radiation oncologist, we are fascinated for only two things, that my target is adequately covered or not, and at the same time, my organ at risk are getting optimal doses, what I want to achieve. If this you can achieve, you are successful. And target volume, as I had already mentioned, it includes the primary disease along with the lymph nodes. That's and this I'm talking about the gross disease. And regional lymph nodes, again, which we call as an elective nodal, it includes your bilateral, internal, iliac, external, iliac, presacral, perirectal, obturator, and inguinal lymph node, which comes into your elective nodal volumes. Now, coming on to the beam arrangement or alignment, we all, at least people from my generation and Dudu's generation, we have seen the patient being treated on cobalt also, and I'm sure some of you might have even now also you might be seeing or you might have seen in the past. So parallel opposed APP field is something which is very commonly given in the clinicals. If you are doing a clinical planning, apart from that four field box technique, because this will be giving a more homogeneous distribution. Apart from that, in the conformal, you can either do a 3D conformal or you can do an intensity modulated under image guidance. So these are the techniques which is available with most of us. Now, coming on to this guidelines, which basically it describes the clinical planning of a CNL canal. Especially my younger colleagues, you all might be remembering, as I told, RTUG 9811. It was a Jafar Ajani's paper from MD Anderson. This trial started in 1997 or 1998, I'm forgetting, and the result, and it completed in 2005. And in 2008, the paper was published. In the RTOG 9811 and another trial, Act 2, these are these two trials on which the clinical plannings are based. So I like you to just concentrate on these this couple of slides because these are more theoretical, so it is difficult to imbibe, but I'll try to make it simple. Clinical planning in CANL canal is done by a shrinking field technique. So that's number one. Now, and it's being planned in a phase manner, phase one or phase two and boost, you know. Now coming on to the phase one. Phase one, we have in a clinical planning, as I told, we have one AP field, okay? We all are seeing. And then we also have a PA field. Okay, fine. Now, in AP field, the superior border, it lies at L5-S1. And the inferior border, it lies at 2.5 centimeters around the anus or the tumor. So inferior border, it is below the tumor, which is nearly 2.5 centimeters. Now, the lateral border is basically, it will include the inguinal lymph node and it is based on the bony landmark that it will be lying lateral to the femur head, or you can say in the neck of the femur. And this will include the inguinal lymph node. That's important. Now, what about the PA field? PA field will be almost similar to the superior border of the AP field. So superior border is above the sacroiliac joint, which will be almost corresponding to the AP field superior border. The inferior border also will be approximately the same, that is 3 centimeters below the anal verge. The difference is the lateral border. The lateral border in posterior, it is constricted, that it is smaller because it is pushed more towards the medial aspect. And this is just to save the femur head. So PA field, lateral inguinal lymph nodes are not included. And why it is not included? Because we want to spare the femur head. So AP, we include the femur head. And in return, the benefit what we get is the inguinal lymph nodes are irradiated. But in PA, we spare it And thereby, the inguinal lymph node, the lateral inguinal lymph nodes are not getting irradiated. And this is the phase one plan. Hope it's clear. Can anybody just say yes if I'm clear or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you so much. And in phase one, we give a dose to 30.6 × 10^17 fraction. But so this is the AP. Now let's see the PA. This is the phase one. Now let's go to the phase two. The phase two, the difference is that the superior border, which was at L5S1, has been decreased and it has been brought down to the sacroiliac joint. So the superior border has been decreased to the sacroiliac joint. Okay, and this is the what I was talking about, the sacroiliac joint, the superior border has been decreased. Okay, and if there is no inguinal lymph nodes up front, then after 36 gray, you can even decrease your lateral border. Now you can just see that here, even the lateral borders can be decreased. So additional field reduction can be done if there is no inguinal lymph node. PA field will remain same as in phase one. So that's the thing, you know. So it's easier to remember AP is a bigger field, PA is a smaller field. Smaller field in relation to the lymph node per se. So because you want to spare the lymph node, and the doses what is given is 30.6 × 17 fractions. And the other thing is that in phase two, you have to just decrease the border from superior to the, that is L5S1, to the sacroiliac joint. So that's the thing. And what's the phase three? So phase one, phase two, I discussed. The phase three is basically the tumor, that is gross disease, tumor plus node with 2.5 cm of margin. And that's the, and what dose we are giving that in phase one, we give 30.6 to 36. In 17 to 20 fractions, and in phase two, almost 9 to 14.4, and total dose in phase one, phase two is 45 × 25. The phase three, which is ideally this, that the just the boost part, we can say that receives around 10 to 14 gray in 5 to 7 fractions. So total dose, what you'll be getting in 9811 is 55 to 59 gray. So that's, and so 9811, it deals with the phase manner, phase one, phase two, and phase three. And we have different doses in phase one, phase two, and phase three. And again, phase one, AP and PA fields are different. In phase two, the AP field is basically shrunk, okay? But the PA field remains the same as in phase one. And in phase three, it is just the local boost what we are giving, okay? Now, this is something again which complicates the issue, because in PA, as I told, the fields were restricted. So the doses to the inguinal lymph nodes were basically, since I have restricted my field from the posterior, so the inguinal lymph node will be underdosed, because my contribution is only from the AP. PA, I have already covered it, so I'll not be getting the adequate doses. So in order to compensate that, I'll have to give a lateral electron, that is inguinal boost by electrons, you know. So that's something which is, again, it becomes complicated, but that's the way it is, that you have to compensate it by giving electron boost so that your inguinal lymph nodes are adequately covered. Now coming on to the alternative technique, that is after getting APPA, what boost what we are giving, that boost can be even given by a 3D conformal, I mean 3D conform and three field, that is one as a posterior and two lateral field, and that can give a good conformity. And the advantage is that your small bowel can be saved. So this is an alternative technique after APPA. In order to save the bowel, you can give it by three field technique, what we say. As I told, that clinical planning is done by either RTOG 9811, that's one guideline in which it is given in three phases, phase one, phase two, and phase three. There is another option, that is by ACT 2. RTOG is an American guideline and ACT 2 is an European guideline. And also you remember, I told that ACT 2 has the highest number of patients, nearly 200 patients with 2×2 factorial trial. ACT 2 is relatively, it is simpler, we can say. In this also we have phase wise, that is phase one and phase two. phase one, we give 30.6 and 17. Now, what is it? It is much simpler. The superior border of the phase one is 2 centimeter above the inferior aspect of the sacroiliac joint, or 3 centimeters above the gross tumor. So example, either it can be at the bony landmark, that is inferior aspect of the sacroiliac joint, or if there is a growth, wherever the growth ends from there, 3 centimeter above, and whichever is higher, that's the thing. So it will be including your gross tumor, or if there is a node, if there is a node, that also has to be included, but it is primarily based on the bony landmark, that is inferior aspect of the sacroiliac joint, or from the growth 3 centimeter above, whichever is superior. Inferior border is much simpler, just wherever the growth ends from there, or from the anal margin 3 centimeters below, that becomes the inferior border. So either from the growth 3 centimeter down, or from the anal margin 3 centimeter down, whichever is inferior, that's the thing. And the lateral border is lateral to the femoral head. So simple. It's a bony landmark, either at the inferior border of the sacroiliac joint, or from the tumor 3 centimeter above, whichever is higher. Inferior border is again wherever the extent of the tumor ends, from there 3 centimeter down, or from the anal margin 3 centimeter down. Lateral is the lateral border of the femoral head. This is by the Act 2, which is from European guidelines. In phase 1, we give 30.6 grain 17 fractions. Now, phase 2, the fields are being reduced. And now we give 19.8 in 11 fractions. Now, here we have two scenarios in phase 2. One, if there is node negative, or one, which is node positive. Now, node negative means that there is no involved node which has to be treated electively. So, here in phase 2, if you want to give the boost, whatever the tumor is, just give a 3 centimeter concentric margin throughout and make a square field, and that you can give it as a boost to 9.8 in 11 fractions. So it's very, very simple, but this is for the node negative. Now, what about the node positive? Just see over here, this is the anal canal growth, and there is an involved lymph node over here, which could, so if we want to include this lymph node also along with this, so from the node also, I'll have to take 3 centimeters margin all across, up plus with the growth, the primary growth, what do we have, that also has to be included with 3 centimeter margin, and then we'll make a field, and this will be basically, this is for the node positive, where the you want to include the nodes along with the primary, and you can shield it either by a block or you can by the MLC. So remember, RTOG 9811 had a phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3, and the other clinical plan which can be done by the Act 2 trial, which is from Europe, has phase 1 and phase 2. It is more of a bony landmark plans, very simple and doable. And total dose, what will be, you can give 30.6 and 19.8, it is 50.4. And the last line of Act 2 trials, what they write is that 50.4 is the standard of care what they follow. Okay, so this is again what we draw it for the explanation. We had taken a topo on our system, and we had just drawn the line in phase 1, it is at the sacroiliac joint, and this we can see the anal verge. From there 3 centimeter down, there was a lymph node over here, so from there we have taken 3 centimeter all along, and then we can make a field. This is our phase one plan at the APNPA, 30.6 in 17 fractions. And then the phase two means we have included the lymph nodes, and lymph nodes along with that we had given a 3 centimeters margin all across, plus this is our gross node. And then we have taken one entire field, which is a phase 2. Total dose is 50.4. This is more for a diagrammatic representation. Hope I'm clear till here.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So now, till here, everything was going fine. We were very happy. The treatment was being done. But what was not happy, being clinician, is the toxicities. And toxicities are something in anal canal, which is really, it's a nightmare, particularly for the patient, for the clinicians, and many a times because of the toxicities, it's not related to the chemotherapy induced, which I'm, for the time being, at least I'm forgetting that 5-FU and mitromycin C, what it can cause, but the radiation itself, the kind of a skin toxicity which you see is something which is really, it is really, I mean, very, very painful for the patient and as well as for the clinician. And here, what is very interesting, I wrote this slide as a mind the gap. Even in Act 1 UKCCR, you can see they have a planned gap of 6 weeks. In URTC trial, they have a planned gap of 6 weeks and 2 weeks. And why these gaps were given? It was primarily to tackle the toxicities. And after the 6 weeks when the patient came, then they had given the boost. So can we do something where we don't have to give the gap and yet the toxicities are acceptable? And from the patient's perspective and from the clinician's perspective, we do succeed. And that answer is the conformal therapy, either in the form of 3D conformal or the intensity modulated. If you look at the intensity modulated, therapy, the primary aim of this therapy is basically to minimize the toxicity and to avoid a treatment break and adequate target coverage. Now for the IMRT also, we do have a guideline, and this guidelines comes from the RTOG 0529. And again, this comes from the Lisa Kachnick group from US, where Meyerson is also one of the co-authors. And this is basically a phase two trial dose painted IMRT for T2 to T4. And the primary endpoint of this trial was basically grade 2 GI and GU toxicity. And RTOG 529 basically guides us that what should be the target volume for your intensity modulated radiation. And it's very interesting that their endpoint was that they had compared with the historical control. That this is again RTOG American study, and they had compared with RTOG 9811, and they wanted that at least if the toxicity is 15% less as compared to RTOG 9811. That was the primary endpoint, and secondary endpoint was a reduction of all adverse event. And this is a dose painted IMRT. Now, if you go into the details of this, though it could not meet the primary endpoint, but yet the toxicity was definitely, it was lesser. Target volume, as I had already mentioned, it includes the primary disease with the gross lymph nodes. And apart from that, the elective lymph node, which I've again mentioned. But what is important, the treatment volume. The treatment volume is that the grade, the gross disease with the margin along with the nodes, and also to include regional lymph nodes. I'm just skipping this because I'll be showing it in the format of a contouring, which we had done in our department just for this purpose. So contouring on the planning CT scan, I have taken the representative scans, though it is not in too much details, but I think it will give us an idea that what this RTOG 529 is all about and how to contour and how to plan. So to begin with, most of the slides are made by Dr. Riddhi, Dr. Mukti, and Dr. Ashish. They have done it, and I am only the person who are reading it out. So it is to begin with, I like, because last 10 minutes just remaining, so let's concentrate over here. So just identify the gross disease. So what we have identified, the gross disease. And once you identify the gross disease, just contour that, and that we call it as a GTV primary. And this gross disease is not only taken into account by the imaging, but also by the endoscopic findings, and not to forget my clinical findings as well. So this is my GTV primary, very simple. Now, from the GTV primary, we give a 2.5 centimeter and isotropic isocentric margin around my GTV. Once if I give my margin of 2.5 centimeter, it becomes quite large. So I crop it from the ischiorectal fossa, I crop it from the muscles, and I crop it from the bones. So I crop it from these three structures, and then what I get? I get CTV primary. So GTV primary is clear. CTV primary is clear after giving 2.5 centimeter margin and then cropping it off. So two structures are clear. So let's keep it aside. Coming on to the nodes. Now this node, what I'm talking about is the involved nodes. I mean, this is the gross nodes. Okay. So I'm contouring the gross node, and this I'm calling it as a GTV node. Okay. So GTV node, I have contoured it. And after this, I have given a margin according to the RTOG, 1 centimeter, and as per Nancy Lee, she says for onto 1.5 centimeters. So we give a 1 centimeter margin around the node, and this we call it as a CTV node gross. So we have contoured the CTV gross. We have, so just again to recap, because we tend to forget that again and again. I'm going back. Sorry. I'm sorry. So we started with GTV Prime. We started with GTV primary, for that we had contoured. Then after contouring the GTV primary, we had given a margin of 2.5 centimeters to make it as the CTV primary. Then after editing it, we called it as a CTV primary. Then we took the notes, and then after giving a 1 centimeter margin, we called it as a CTV node. So CTV primary and CTV gross nodes are ready. Okay, now let us take the vessels, because these vessels will be basically guiding about the elective volume, that what lymph node volumes are we treating. So for treating against CTV vessels, at the standard what we follow, but in anal canal, it basically you start contouring the CTV vessels just below the bifurcation of the common iliac artery. So start over here and continue scrolling down, keep on drawing the internal and external iliac vessels. So external iliac vessels and internal iliac vessels, keep on scrolling down till you reach either the pubic symphysis superior aspect or the obturator foramen. Here you stop it. So your external iliac is contoured and your internal iliac is also contoured. So this I'm talking about the iliac vessels, both external iliac as well as the internal iliac. And the external and internal iliac we have to stop where I could see the pubic symphysis or obturator foramen. That's one thing. So internal iliac contouring, I'll stop it over here. But the external iliac, I'll still keep on contouring because I have to include the inguinal lymph node also. So external iliac, it will continue as a femoral vessel till the lower border of the saphenofemoral junction is reached. So saphenofemoral junction is reached over here. So sapheno and femoral junction. So I'll continue the external iliac vessels contouring, which will ultimately merge into the femoral vessels till I reach the saphenofemoral junction. And saphenofemoral junctions, when I reach, still the CTV will still continue for the 2 centimeters beyond, because I have to include the inguinal lymph node. So internal iliac is stopped, external iliac you continue till you continue the femoral vessels till you reach the saphenofemoral junction, and beyond that also 2 centimeters beyond that, so that your inguinal lymph nodes are covered. So with this, how the CTV vessels I have contoured. CTV vessels, again, to revise, we started below the bifurcation of the common iliac. I went on contouring internal iliac till I could see the pubic symphysis and the obturator foramen. External iliac went on to continue to the femoral till I reached the saphenofemoral junction and 2 centimeters beyond that. So this is the way the CTV vessels look like. Now, in order to get a CTV vessels, CTV nodes, I have to give a 0.7 centimeters margin to the CTV vessels. And according to the Meyerson's atlas, it is 0.8 centimeters. And from that, I have to edit from the muscles and bone. And in order to include the presacral group of lymph node, I'll take a 1 centimeter brush and I will contour till S2, S3 junctions or the appearance of the piriform muscle. So this is basically how we are drawing the CTV to get a CTV nodes. Okay. Now, some couple of small things like external iliac, what we have drawn and then given a 0.7 margin. But here at the anterolateral aspect of the external iliac vessels, in order to include the external iliac nodes, I'll take 1 centimeter margin so that my external iliac nodes are covered. And to combine external iliac with internal iliac, we all know in the gynecological atlas by Taylor, 1 centimeter brush we take and we join the external iliac with internal iliac. And again, in Meyerson paper, it is written as 1.8 centimeter. And in the inguinal region, once what we had traced, external iliac, we continued till femoral vessels, till saphenofemoral junction and 2 centimeters beyond we had taken as a vessels. In order to include the inguinal lymph node, we take 2 centimeters margin around the vessels and we crop it from the muscles so that we could include the inguinal lymph node. So this is the CTV nodes. But one thing is, again, or just one thing is missing from this part. That means, again, to quick recap, because we tend to forget again and again, external iliac till common iliac bifurcation, we started contouring. External iliac, internal iliac, till internal iliac we stopped. External iliac, we went on to continue till femoral, till saphenofemoral, till 2 centimeters beyond. Then we gave a margin of 7 mm around the vessels to include the nodes. And at the level of external iliac, we took 1 centimeter so the external group of lymph nodes are included. But in the inguinal region, in order to get that, we have to get a 2 centimeters margin with after cropping from the muscles, so that inguinal lymph nodes are included. Only one thing is that the perirectal group of lymph node is still not included in this. And for including perirectal group of lymph nodes, you have to contour something called a CTV mesorectum. And how CTV mesorectum is contoured? It is very, very simple. You start contouring from the anorectal junction, come down gradually till you could see that limiter ani is entering into the pelvic diaphragm. So this will be CTV mesorectum, and this is basically perirectal group of lymph node. Okay, so if we see that whatever contouring we have done, this is just an elective node. So elective node means a CTV node. Now CTV node, we all know that time and I think two or three times I've repeated the CTV node, that is one, plus the addition what we had taken as a CTV mesorectum, which is nothing but the perirectal group of lymph nodes. So the CTV nodes, which is entire this as a CTV node, plus the CTV mesorectum, which is a perirectal node, this will be called as a CTV elective nodes. Okay, so quick recap of the CTV. CTV primary, if you say the gross disease plus 2.5 centimeters, we all remember the first two slides which we said in the contouring. The CTV nodes, again the gross node with 1 centimeter margin, again we remember. And the third thing is that CTV elective nodes, which includes the pelvic node, that is iliac, obturator and presacral, inguinal lymph node, and the perirectal group of lymph node, which we'll be calling as a CTV mesorectum. So all these three are the three different CTVs. And you have to give margin of 1 centimeter to each to call it as a PTV primary, PTV elective, PTV elective nodes, and PTV involved nodes. So these three volumes with three independent 1 centimeter margin to make it PTV, and accordingly you have to guide your dose according to it. Now, hope I have not made it confusing, but that's the way it is. Though it looks confusing, but yet it's simple. Basically, we are having three volumes. One is CTV primary, CTV involved nodes, and CTV elective nodes. And we have to give margin to each to get.
Allah, Sibbin, agar niya to paray na ila. Amma Sibbin le udan
kudo na ekke na. So coming on to the dose prescription from the 05, if it is node negative, then the elective nodes, that is elective nodes, what I'm talking about, the elective nodes here, elective nodes will just receive 42 gray in 28 fractions, and the PTV primary, that is PTV primary, because this node is not coming into the play because it's N0, so the PTV primary will be getting 50.4 in 28 fractions. So simple, elective will get 42 and PTV primary gets 50.4 gray. Now for T3, T4, that and the node positive, there the issue is that the elective nodes, what I'm saying, will be getting a higher dose. Here elective nodes are getting 42, here elective nodes are getting 45. The PTV primary will be getting 54. Now the catch is only in this particular. If the PTV nodes, which is involved nodes, if it is more than 3 centimeters, give the same dose what you are giving to the PTV primary. But if it is less than 3 centimeters, just give 50.4. So that's the thing. Simple, T2N0, elective nodes will just 40. Only we have two volumes, that is 42 in 28 and 50.4 in 28 fractions. But the issue is only in this advanced T and node positive. Elective nodes is the least the dose, 45 in 30 and 54 in 30 to the primary. Depending upon the involved nodal size, if the size is more than 3, go ahead and give 54 in 30 or else 50.4 in 30 fractions. That's the thing. If you compare the 9811 and 529, there is not much of a difference except for one which I say, the 529, it does not differentiate something called as high risk or the low risk, which is present in the 9811. So because 529 is primarily for the IMRT, hence we don't have any low risk region. That's the main difference what we say. OAR constraint dose will not go into details. Again, it is but it is definitely different. We have to remember because here the doses are different from what the Contec guideline says. And what we are doing as such in our department, we have tried to, we have got influenced by Dr. Indranil Malik from Tata Medical Center when he started, and we have tried to copy his idea with CTV primary by gross tumor with 2 centimeters margin. CTV nodes, that is involved nodes, I'm talking again gross node with 1 centimeter margin, and CTV elective nodes, that is pelvic with inguinal, and entire PTV gets a CTV with 0.7 margin. So this is our target volume, CTV primary nodes and elective. The entire phase one, we give 36 and 20 to the entire volume we give. But in phase two, it becomes the PTV primary and the PTV involved node, we give 18, 3 and 10 fractions. And elective, we remove it. So that's the thing. It's the phase manner, phase one and phase two. Chemotherapy is again standard, that is capecitabine and mitomycin C. And we don't have any planned break, though our experiences are limited. But it is definitely the toxicity is acceptable and the patients are competent. And of late, in the last 1 year, we have got only two patients. One patient failed locally and one patient failed loco-regionally. That's the thing. With this, we'll end the topic. Thanks a lot. I mean, these are my teachers who taught me the basics again and again, I say. And my lovely team who made this entire presentation for me most of the time. And I am just to present over here. Thank you, Dudul. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much.